Okay, good morning, everyone. So let us start the lecture today, right? Today we'll be talking about drug discovery and development, and we'll be basically focusing on COVID-19 drugs and the vaccine. Okay, so drug discovery and development was something that we normally dealt in the practicals, as I said earlier, right? And FDA stands for Food and Drug Administration. This is a governing body for registering the drugs out there in USA, right? The drug development process, as you can see in FDA website, which has been listed down here at the end, right? You can see that there are five different steps that has been mentioned. The first step is of discovery and development. The second is preclinical research. The third is clinical research. Then comes the FDA review and FDA post-marketing surveillance. Moving on to the discovery. Okay, so normally for discovery, what happens is that typically the researchers, they discover new drugs through new insights into a disease process, right? You understand as to how a disease works or how the disease progresses, and they try and stop that very step or reverse the effects of a disease. That is how it works. Many tests of the molecular compounds are done so as to find the possible effects against any of the large number of diseases. And again, there are existing treatments that have unanticipated effects. Right now, what we are doing is the world is trying to use remdesivir for COVID-19, right? It was not developed for COVID. In the development phase, once the researchers, they identify a promising compound for development, what is done is they try to conduct various experiments to help gather information on the pharmacokinetics of the drugs, that is absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion. Similarly, to also find out the potential benefits and the mechanism of action of the drug. Also, to identify the best doses and the best way to give the drug, maybe like to identify the best route of giving the drug, which may be by mouth, by injection, or any other sites that we have talked about, right? We have talked about many routes of administration of drugs. Also, to find out about the side effects and adverse effects and how it affects different groups of people, that is by gender, race, ethnicity, and how it interacts with other drugs and treatments. However, how a drug interacts with other drugs and treatments, they are found out only in phase 4 and first 3 clinical trial phase. It is not much, we don't find much detail on about this. Its effectiveness is compared with similar drugs. Okay, now comes to preclinical research. Now that a drug has been discovered by different means, right, and the development has been done, so the next step is preclinical research. And preclinical research is mandatory because you don't want to harm a patient, right, and you'd rather harm an animal rather than harm a person. But then again, there are again animal rights activists who say that we should not even harm animals as such. So it doesn't directly go just to animals, but then it goes to different phases. There's animal studies also, and then likely side by side there is cell culture, tissue culture, and there are computer aided studies also that goes on. But then animal studies is still very much important, and it is still done. So preclinical studies is done in both in vitro and in vivo, right? In vivo means that it is conducted in animal studies, and FDA requires all these studies to be conducted using good laboratory practices. And GLP stands for good laboratory practices, which defines a set of regulations and like study conduct, the number of personnel, the kind of facilities that should be there, the equipment, written protocols, operating procedures, study reports, all these things, they ought to be gathered in form of data and they ought to be validated so that one can go for clinical research. Usually, preclinical studies is not very large. However, studies must provide detailed information on dosing and toxicity levels. And after preclinical testing, the researchers review their finding and decide whether the drug should be tested. Following preclinical research, there is a clinical research, right, which refers to the studies or trials that are done in people. As the developers design the clinical study, they will consider to go into the clinical research. And before they move on to the clinical research, they need to submit an application called IND application, which stands for Investigational New Drug Process. And they submit FDA an application with all the data that they have collected from the preclinical research, and then that IND application goes into review. The normally FDA requires around 30 days to review the original IND application, and what it basically does it, this process helps protects the volunteer who participate in the clinical trials from unnecessary harm to the patient, right? IND normally responds in two ways. It either approves the clinical trials or there is a clinical hold, which is relatively rare. However, the hold may be if participants are exposed to unreasonable or significant risk, when the investigators, they are not qualified, when materials for the volunteer participants are misleading, and when IND application does not include enough information about the trial risk, then in those cases, the clinical hold is there. Otherwise, the IND gives approval after the FDA gives approval to the IND. Have a look at this chart. This is the drug discovery and development chart, right? First is the target, the step of target identification. Target is expressed and functional. They normally try and identify a target. Target can be any receptor. It can be a protein. It can be an enzyme. It can be anything. So that helps alter the disease process. Let's say in case of hypercholesterolemia, right? There are drugs called, class of drugs called statin, which is H-enzyme coenzyme A reductase inhibitors, right? So H-enzyme coenzyme A out here is a target, and drugs that act on those targets were identified as statins later on. So you first need to identify the target, which is identified through genomics and proteomics. That is the study of genomes and proteins, right? And there is compound screening that happens in a very high level. There are lots and lots of compounds that are screened in one go, right? And then preclinical testing of the lead compound is done. So the relative efficacy of different agents that is studied, the species variation is seen, biodistribution and pharmacokinetics is seen, toxicity and safety studies are done, validating the imaging for subsequent trial, subsequent clinical use is done. Like with regards to the species variation, possibly I had talked to you guys when I was talking to you guys about metabolism. I talked about this species variation where I mentioned the idea that diclofenac was very much toxic to pulses, right? When diclofenac was used in veterinary purpose, the drug diclofenac, which is a painkiller that was used in veterinary purpose as well earlier, what happened is that when the animals died, the animals were left to rot, and the pulses they fed on the carcass. Even the very small minute amount of the drug that was there in the carcass of the dying animal, it was very much toxic to the pulses, and it resulted in death of hundreds of pulses. So what it shows is that there is species variation in toxicity as well and in terms of action as well. The same diclofenac, which is relatively non-toxic to us, we take it regularly for different kind of pain, right? Especially the pain related with joints, the muscle pain, we take it very regularly. But then that same drug, when it was given to the animals, and when the pulses ate the carcass of the animals, they died all of a sudden. So there is species variation of different drugs. That's why the drugs, they are checked on two different species before they are checked in humans during the phase of preclinical testing. Okay, then comes the clinical trials, right? Phase 1 and phase 2 trials, phase 3 trials out here, they form the process of drug development where efficacy, safety, human pharmacokinetics, the dose adjustment and availability of the drug is checked. And lastly, the clinical use of the drug begins, and phase four study also begins. And we had mentioned of investigational new drug application, right? Investigational new drug application is applied somewhere before the clinical testing is begun, and new drug application is applied before phase 4 trials, and it encompasses all the data that has been obtained so far. Okay, have a look at this chart. This chart also shows the same thing of target validation, compound screening, secondary assays, and in vitro analysis, whereby the candidate drug goes into clinical testing of the drug, right? Target validation, again, you identify the target, you try to validate the target if it exists there, and different kind of knockdown mice are used, genetic knockdown mice are used to check if the target is there, and if the drug acts on the target, then there are different sorts of drugs that are screened in the phase of compound screening. This is the picture of 96 well plates out here. Different concentrations of the drug, of different drugs are placed out here and checked for the effect of the drug. And this can be done through high throughput screening as well, and different steps are done. Then secondary assays of the drug are carried out through cell culture and tissue culture, and in vivo analysis are carried out, and then the candidate drug moves forward to clinical testing of the drug or clinical trials. Okay, have a look at this chart again. This is the same chart where it shows, okay, what is the number of the drug that enters out here in the level of screening, and what is the number that comes to the level of the approved drug, right? We see that thousands of drugs, they are screened for hit, and then hit to lead, there may be around hundreds of drugs that come from the level of hit to level of lead. That is, level of hit is all those drugs that can work on the target is hit, right? And then all those workable drugs that can have effects in the humans, or that show good pharmacokinetic data, they are called leads. And then the number decreases out here. The lead, hit to lead optimization is there. Then candidates that seek the preclinical drug development, the number decreases from thousands to 1, 2, 3, right? And again, there is preclinical development phase and then the clinical development phase. So there are lots of phases that help screen the drug and choose the best possible drug for treatment of the disease. And there are different things that are included out here. There is a term called bioprinting, right? And this is a picture of a 3D printed, bioprinted heart out here. I did mention about heat to lead, right? Okay, this is also known as lead generation, and it is a stage in early drug discovery where small molecule heats from high throughput screening are evaluated and undergo limited optimization to identify the promising lead compounds to work on. So the main idea, the main aim of this stage is to refine each heat series so that you produce more potent and selective compounds which possess pharmacokinetic properties to examine the efficacy in vivo models. Okay, have a look at this picture. You at least identify with agonist and antagonist, right? You've learned what agonist is and what antagonist is. So in the phase of drug discovery and development, if there is an agonist drug being tried, then the response will be generally seen in 100%, right? So you are seeing more response with agonist, but however, if you are looking for an antagonistic drug, then the response will be more clustered towards the low level. That is, it might be either negative or in zero phase. So antagonist will be either blocking the effects totally or reversing the effects too, while agonistic drug will be increasing the effects of the drug. Okay, putting into perspective what we have just talked about, it can take up to 10 to 15 years to develop one new medicine from earliest stages of discovery to the time it is available for treating the patients. Many of the drugs that come to the market in 2020 were in the early stages of discovery somewhere 15 years ago, back in 2005. So drug discovery is a pretty lengthy process. The average cost to research and develop each successful drug is estimated to be few billion US dollars. And this number includes the cost of thousands of failures as well. For every 5,000 to 10,000 compounds that enter the research and development, only one drug receives approval. So the pharmaceutical industries need to research multiple drugs, and only one of them might get approved. The pharmaceutical sector also have coined a phrase called Valley of Death, in which only one drug out of 10,000 chemical entities are commercialized or come out as a drug after intensive research of 10 to 15 years. So this sums the whole process again, right? The drug research, where the compound selection is done through high throughput screening. This began somewhere in 1985. Before that, this was still a tedious process. And then there is selection of promising leads. Medicinal chemistry is involved out there, where you make the structure activity related changes. Structural changes are made so that it shows the wanted kind of activity. If it has drug-like properties, then it goes into formulation. If it doesn't have drug-like properties, then again, few other molecular changes are made to the agent, and then to see if they have drug-like properties. If they have drug-like properties, they are formulated into different drug formulations. We have talked about the different dosage forms, right? So different dosage forms are made out here. and then the process of development is done, analytical development is done, right? And preliminary, you do the animal pharmacokinetics and toxicity from in the preclinical testing, then investigational new drug application is applied, then clinical testing of phase 1, phase 2, phase 3 is done. Once the phase 3 testing is completed, a new drug application is submitted to the FDA. FDA reviews it in a span of 6 to 10 months, and then there is a global launch of the drug, following which there is phase 4 studies. Okay, there is a short description of clinical trials in a video that I've taken, right? It is given by the FDA, and it gives you the example of cancer drugs. Have a look.
Clinical trials are research studies that involve people. Most clinical trials to test new cancer treatments are done in a series of steps called phases. If a new treatment is successful in one phase, it moves to the next phase. Let's take a look at the three main phases of clinical trials. Phase 1 trials are small, enrolling less than 30 patients. Phase 1 trials are designed to find a safe dose of the new treatment, determine how the treatment should be given, and learn how it affects the body. If a safe dose is found, the new treatment goes to phase 2 testing. More patients are enrolled, usually 100 or less. Phase 2 trials study how the treatment affects the body and how the treatment works for a certain type of cancer. If a new treatment is found to be safe and to have some benefit, it goes to phase 3. This is when many participants are needed, usually more than 100 and sometimes thousands. Phase 3 trials compare the new treatment with the current treatment to see which one is better. One thing is certain with any phase trial. By taking part, you will help future patients by helping today's scientists learn more about cancer. For more information about clinical trials, including their possible risks and benefits for you, go to cancer.gov/clinical trials.
Okay. So that was a short video on clinical trials, right? So you understood something on clinical trials. So let us have a look at it again. We talked about the drug discovery and development phase till the level of preclinical testing, right? Now, after an IND application, the drug comes to the level of clinical trials, and phase 1, phase 2, and phase 3 trials are started. As shown in the video before, there are less number of participants in phase 1. The number of participants increases to few hundreds in phase 2 and thousands in the level of phase 3 clinical trials. Then there is an NDA application is submitted to the FDA for review, right? NDA stands for new drug application. The FDA then confirms the safety and effectiveness of the drug and then allows the drug into clinical use, where the phase 4 studies are carried out. Okay, in that very video, it talked about clinical trials in phase 1, phase 2, and phase 3 only, right? Phase 1 studies, they are there to assess the safety of a drug or device. Phase 2 studies help test the efficacy of the drug. Phase 3 studies, they involve the randomized blind testing in several hundred to several thousand patients. And out here in this very phase, they are checked against old drugs that were used in that very case, right? If you are looking for a new alternative to an existing drug, then that kind of testing is done in phase 3 studies. And phase 4 refers to post-marketing surveillance, where the surveillance is carried out after the drug is marketed. Because till phase 3, you are carrying on the study in thousands of people. But then once the drug clears phase 3 studies and FDA has given approval, then the drug will move to post-marketing surveillance, where they will first give to few surveillance centers, where they will use it in thousands of more people and try and collect data on new drug. Okay, so rewinding whatever we just saw earlier, this is phase 1 study in which 20 to 100 healthy volunteers or the people with disease or condition used, and the length of the study out here is several months. The main purpose of the study is to identify the safety and the doses of the drug, and approximately 70% of the drugs that enter phase one drug clinical trial, they move on to the next phase or phase two. Okay, phase two is the study in which the efficacy and the side effects of the drug are found, and it involves around several hundred people with disease or condition. The length of the study may be several months to 2 years, and approximately 33% of the drugs move to next phase. Then comes phase three. In phase three, the study participants are around 300 to 3000, and the length of the study ranges from 1 to 4 years, and the purpose out here is to find out the efficacy and monitoring the adverse reactions of the drugs. Approximately 25 to 30% of the drug, they move to the next phase again. Okay, and following the phase one, phase two, and phase three of clinical trials, a new drug application is submitted to the FDA, right? And it will try to demonstrate that the drug is safe and effective for the intended purpose. If it is not safe or effective, it will not come to the level of clinical trial phase three. It will not even complete phase three, right? So the clinical trial studies will be truncated whenever there is a problem with the drug. So the drug developer must include everything detailed about the drug, from preclinical data to phase three trial data, in the new drug application. And also there will be proposed labeling, safety updates, drug abuse information, patient information, and directions for use. Okay, then comes phase four study, which we call post-marketing surveillance as well. 7,000 volunteers or people who have disease or condition, they take part in the study. And the main idea of the phase four study is to identify the safety and efficacy of the drug. This is in the stage of phase four, that interactions of the drug with different other drugs and interaction with diseases, they are found in phase four. Now let us have a look at the vaccine discovery and development. In the 1980s, the discovery of the vaccine took long time as compared to the development of the vaccine. In that, more time went into the research of finding out the vaccine. But nowadays, with different new techniques, the discovery phase has been reduced. However, the development phase has increased because of increased size of clinical trials that has been mandated. So again, the vaccine discovery to development takes somewhere between 10 to 15 years again. Right. Okay, this is the vaccine development timeline again. Right. This shows post discovery to pre-regulatory submission. So we saw earlier that discovery takes a pretty long time. Right. And after the discovery as well, there are lots of things that goes on. Quite like the drugs itself, the vaccine also go through the same process. So there is preclinical testing, preclinical stock. If it passes the safety and fails efficacy, then it comes here. It stops out here itself. Right. If it passes safety and efficacy, then it moves forward. Then there is clinical stock of the drug that is generated. The clinical trials go on. If it passes this safety and efficacy study out here, then industrial manufacturing of the drug is done and the final product is launched. So even the post-discovery, it takes a pretty long time. And the study can be truncated anytime if there is a problem with the drug, right? If there is a problem with safety and efficacy of the drug, basically with the safety of the drug. This shows the different vaccines that were introduced at different time periods. You can have a look at it later on. This was the timeline of the different vaccines that were introduced. Now let us look into the coronavirus drugs and vaccines. Scientists around the world, they are working on potential treatments and vaccines for the new coronavirus disease, right? Several companies, they are working on antiviral drugs, and most of them are already in use against other diseases. Other companies, they are working on vaccines that can be used as preventive measure against the disease. The CDER in the US, it is engaged in numerous activities to protect and promote public health during COVID pandemic, ranging from acceleration of development for treatments, maintaining and securing drug supply, providing guidance to manufacturers, and advising developers on how to handle clinical trial issues, and also keeping the public informed. So these are the different things. You can have a look at it, what they are doing, the CDER. Okay, this is something that I found in Google search when I did for COVID drugs, right? It was done in 6 May 2020, day before yesterday. So two drugs show promise against COVID-19. Both drugs are FDA approved for other illnesses. Remdesivir, check. It's about the Remdesivir drug, right? We'll talk about these drugs later on as well. And it basically shows that there are not many drugs that are approved or that are in trial for now. Right? Let us have a look at the antivirals story. Several companies, they are developing or testing the antivirals against COVID-19. Antivirals, they work in different ways. One is preventing the virus from replicating, and other is blocking it from infecting the cells. The antivirals, they basically work better if the drugs are given earlier, in the earlier stages of the disease, before significant damage has been done. And with regards to a vaccine is designed to help protect the people before they are exposed to a virus, right? A vaccine basically trains the immune system to recognize and attack the virus. It protects the person who is vaccinated and also the community, in that a vaccinated person will not transfer the virus to others. Therefore, it will help bring the herd immunity a little close. There is a term of herd immunity circulating in response to COVID-19 as well. We'll talk about herd immunity sometime later. Both antivirals and vaccines, they will be valuable tools in combating the COVID-19. However, antivirals are likely to be developed and approved before a vaccine, which takes relatively longer time. And it normally takes a decade or more for a new compound to go from initial discovery to the marketplace. We saw earlier, right? Many compounds never make it that far. And that's why antivirals, being eyed as treatments for COVID-19, they are the drugs that already exist in the market today. Okay, I don't know if some of you have heard about it, but then BCG and polio vaccines are also touted as being helpful in case of coronavirus, right? And it is said that the South Asian people, we have got some sort of resistance to COVID because of the BCG and polio vaccines that we received as a child. Okay, meanwhile, some clinical trials, they are underway in Netherlands and Australia for tuberculosis vaccine to see if it actually provides any protection. The polio vaccine is also being checked if it boosts the immune system to help fight off the new coronavirus. There is no evidence yet to confirm both the theories. Okay, this is in relation to COVID-19 drugs. This was given by WHO, and this was published following Trump saying that hydroxychloroquine can be a useful drug when it comes to treatment of COVID, right? They said that the misuse of hydroxychloroquine can cause serious side effects and illness and even lead to death. Okay, so let us look into the hydroxychloroquine study. European Union, they said that there is no evidence of hydroxychloroquine, which is an anti-malarial drug, being effective in treatment of COVID-19. Later on, in late April, FDA issued a warning saying that serious and potentially life-threatening heart-related problems can be seen with hydroxychloroquine. And also, JAMA, the Journal of American Medical Association, reported that clinical study on chloroquine had been ended because some participants, they had irregular heartbeat, and nearly two dozen people had died earlier because of taking daily doses of medication. Okay, so if there is no hydroxychloroquine, which drug is being used? Let's look into the new drugs that are being used, right? WHO is now conducting a Solidarity clinical trial for COVID-19, and Solidarity clinical trial is an international clinical trial to help find an effective treatment for COVID-19 very soon, right? As soon as possible. This is the basic idea. So what are the four trials that is going on? One is an experimental compound called Remdesivir, right? This drug was originally designed for Ebola and related virus, but it showed no effect back then. However, it was relatively non-toxic, and this drug had antiviral effects against SARS and MERS. So they are checking in case of coronavirus as well. And this is the one which may be one of the best drugs that we have in the fight against coronavirus so far. The anti-malarial drug chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine, they have been trending on social media and news outlets, right? But the results from clinical trials have not convinced the scientific community. A drug combination that is used in HIV patients like lopinavir and ritonavir, which is basically used in HIV patients, now they are also being tested in coronavirus cases. They were used in China. And interferon B in combination with lopinavir and ritonavir, this was found to be useful in animal model of MERS, which is Middle East Respiratory Syndrome. So these are the four different trials that has been going on for COVID-19, as given in by WHO. Okay. Okay, this is a list of vaccines that are in clinical trial phases right now. So you can have a look at this chart later on. I have sent you the PowerPoints. Let us look, how soon will the vaccine be ready? This is the same thing we just discussed earlier as to how long does the vaccine production take, right? It takes somewhere between 10 to 15 years, but the goal of COVID-19 vaccine is to produce it under 18 months, and the government will need to expedite the usual drug approval process in order to deliver the vaccine to over 7 billion people as soon as possible.